Hi guys, tonight's video is on the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, which allows us to get an idea of the frequencies of the different alleles in a population and to get an idea of how a population is changing over time. So the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium states that allelic frequencies in populations remain constant generation to generation unless disturbances occur. Disturbances can include mutation. You guys are familiar with mutation, natural selection, we're good with that too, right? Migration, which means like individuals coming into the population or leaving the population. Genetic drift is when a population gets shrunk down really, really small. Something big happens, they lose their habitat, there's a catastrophic event, something like that, where you end up with just a few individuals. And then non-random mating is basically sexual selection. So when that mating isn't random, when individuals are choosing their mates because of some specific criteria. And in natural populations, the truth is that disturbances are always occurring. At least one of these things, usually multiples of these things, is always occurring in natural populations. So what Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium does is it represents an ideal state against which to measure the degree of change in a population. So populations are always changing, but by looking at Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, we can see how they're changing. And there's two equations that the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium has. And so first of all, the first equation is here, P plus Q equals 1. Well, what does that mean? P is the frequency of the dominant allele in the population. And so if we're using Bs, it would be that big B. So of all, for one trait in all the individuals in the population, how many big B alleles are there? Q is the frequency of the recessive allele. So in the whole population, how many little Bs are there for that one trait? And then it makes sense then that if you add the frequency of the Ps and the frequency of the Qs, we're going to get one. We're going to get the total population. We're going to get all the alleles for that one trait if we look at all the dominants and all the recessives. So that's a pretty easy equation, the first one. Now the second one, if you look all the way at the bottom here, is P squared plus 2PQ plus Q squared equals 1. What is that? That is representing the frequency of the three different three different genotypes for this one trait for a population. And so remember, the three different genotypes are going to be homozygous dominant, homozygous recessive, and heterozygous. So to figure out the frequency of the homozygous dominant individuals, that's represented by P squared. And the reason for that is to get a homozygous dominant individual, you need to get one dominant allele, and you need to get another dominant allele. So it's the frequency of getting one dominant allele times the frequency of getting another dominant allele. So those are, you can look at those like probabilities, and you multiply them. P times P gives you P squared. Same thing for the recessive individual. To get one recessive allele, that's Q. To get another recessive allele, that's also Q. Multiply those together, Q squared. Now to get a heterozygous individual, there's two ways you can get heterozygous. You could either first get a P, then get a Q, or you could get a Q, then a P, right? And so that gives you 2PQ, because there's two ways to get a P and a Q. So now, those three possibilities, when they add together, they're going to equal 1, because if you look at the population, all the genotypes, if you add the frequency of those that are homozygous dominant with the frequency of those that are heterozygous with the frequency of those that are homozygous recessive, you're going to get the entire population 100% or 1. So now, how do these equations help us? Well, if we can calculate the allelic frequencies and we see that they're changing over time, whenever an allelic frequency changes, a population's evolving. So if we start out with, if our P was 0.5 and our Q was 0.5, and then a couple generations later our P is 0.2 and our Q is 0.8, then we know that that population has changed. And so we can infer the degree of change by the degree of change of the allelic frequencies. And at any given point in time, we can calculate the frequency of different alleles if we know the frequency of either one of these two. If we know what P is or we know what Q is, then that's a really easy equation to solve, right? Or if we know one of the genotypic frequencies, we can also figure out the others. But what's tricky is usually what all we can tell from the outside is phenotype, right? Physical appearance. So if we see an individual or in a population, we can count all the individuals that show the dominant trait. We don't know whether they are homozygous dominant or heterozygous, right? But if we see an individual with a recessive phenotype, then we know that their genotype is this recessive genotype, right? They have to be little b, little b. So usually when we're doing Hardy-Weinberg problems or examples, you're going to be given the frequency of that recessive phenotype, which is equal to that homozygous recessive genotype. So here's an example. We have 1 in 2,500 Caucasians has cystic fibrosis. So our Q squared, that's the frequency of the recessive genotype, is 1 in 2,500. And if you divide that out, you get 0.0004. So that gives us the Q squared, right? But if we want the frequency of the different alleles, we want to get back to just P and Q. When we get back to P and Q, we can solve everything else. So if you take the square root of that 0.0004, that'll give us Q, right? Which is 0.02. Once you have Q, it's easy to get P because P plus Q equals 1. So some simple algebra there. 1 minus 0.02 equals 0.98. So that tells us that 98% of the alleles in our population are the dominant allele. So P equals 0.98. Now that we have P and Q, we can solve for any of the genotypes. So let's say we want to know the frequency of carriers in the population. Remember, carriers are the heterozygotes. So heterozygotes are represented by 2PQ. So we just plug everything in. 2 times P times Q equals 0.0392. And that tells us that about 4% of Caucasians are carriers of cystic fibrosis. So we'll have some opportunity to practice this, and you'll really get the hang of it once you do a few practice problems. So see you in class.